say usual corals ay branching yung na-imagine mga tao, but the one we're looking at are the massive ones like varieties. So they can grow for a very long time. So matatanda yan sila. Some of them are 100 years old, some of them more. So you could imagine that it grows and grows throughout the years. And throughout this growth process, ang nangyayari, a lot of things get trapped in their skeletons, which are mostly calcium carbonate. So one of the things that get trapped there is iodine-129. So if we study yung cross-section ng itong mga corals, massive corals na nga ito, so we could measure or read or analyze for various things, and we could reconstruct whatever happened in the ocean throughout the years that the corals were growing.
Magandang araw mga kapwa scientista. Welcome sa BTS or ang Behind the Science podcast, kung saan kakausapin natin ang mga nangungunang siyentista sa kani-kanilang larangan from all over the Philippines. So for today, ang ating guest ay talaga naman pang malakasan tayo today. So he is a scientist one and the current section head of the Nuclear Materials Research Section of DOST, Philippine Nuclear Research Institute, or DOST PNRI. He obtained his BS Chemistry and MS Environmental Science degrees from UP Diliman in 2009 and in 2013. And he obtained his PhD in Nuclear Engineering and Management from the University of Tokyo in Japan in 2016. He has been working in DOST PNRI since 2009, where he specializes in environmental aspects and applications of nuclear energy, science, and technology. So without any further ado, let's all welcome Dr. Angel Bautista VII. Hello, Doc Angel.
Ayun, hello Keith, at magandang araw po sa lahat ng nanonood at nakikinig, and looking forward for this afternoon. Sana mag-enjoy tayo lahat.
Thank you very much, first of all, sir, for accepting our invite to be a guest sa ating podcast. So mag-start muna tayo sa ating segment na tawag namin na The Young and Curious You. So sir, balikan natin yung kabataan ninyo. Kailan nyo po na-realize na gusto nyo magtrabaho sa science sector?
Yung mother ko kasi ay chemist. So I think dun yun nagsimula. Tapos when I was growing up, when I was a kid sa school, yung madalas no elementary, yung favorite subject ko ay science. Nung bata din ako, hindi ko alam kung inabutan nyo pa ito, pero favorite show ko yung Siniskwela. Parang araw-araw, inaabangan ko yung next episode ng Siniskwela. And noong high school, naging parang chemistry din yung favorite subject ko. So parang, I think the interest was always there. But when I was papunta na doon sa work talaga, interest wasn't all naman that came into play kung bakit ako nandito ngayon. So feeling ko it was a convergence ng mga opportunities din, tsaka life decisions. For example, yung choice ng degree or choice ng university, kung anong master's bago gagawin ko or anong work. So it wasn't, I don't credit it all sa planning ko, sa decision making ko. It was a meeting ng opportunities din na na-present sa akin at yung mga napili ko opportunities. Madalas nga eh, yung mga number one choices ko, hindi yung nangyayari sa life ko throughout my journey. Laging hindi nag-work yung parang tingin ko siya na yung best, tapos hindi siya nag-work. Pero it happens, yung eventually kung saan ako napunta, later on, looking back, I realized na mas better pa pala yung path na napuntahan ko. So in that respect, so parang feeling ko I was led or guided somewhere, at least yung belief ko. So kahit ganun journey, I'm very thankful and very happy where I am now. So, yun na yung nangyari, kumbaga.
Yun, sir. So, at a very young age, siyempre, mga batang pinalaki tayo ng siniskwela.
Totoo. Tama.
So, yun yung ano natin, yun yung source natin, sir, ng scientific entertainment back
yes,
then.
Yes, totoo.
Actually, it was kasama pa ata yung matinik. Kung
yes.
Tama yung title na naalala ko.
Yes,
so yung mga shows,
apple, mga ganyan. Yung mga nalalaman yung generations tuloy natin.
Oh, ayan, so alam nyo na, may ballpark na kayo sa ages namin ni Doc Angel. Ayun, at saka sir, I really like yung ano, yung parang medyo go with the flow ka lang na okay, if my first plan doesn't work, the universe will lead me to another opportunity or ano. And that happens for everyone naman, di ba sir?
Totoo. So yung laging parang mantra ko lang sa self ko, talagang kung ano may pinipurso ko. For example, talagang itatry ko lang yung, I will give it my best shot. So kung ano mangyari, I know na yun yung para sa akin. So I always try to make sense sa nangyayari sa life ko. Basta walang regrets kasi binigay mo lahat yung makakaya mo eh. So you look back at it and then you say, ah, ito talaga yung para sa akin. Parang gano'n lang yung ano, belief ko.
Yeah, and at saka magandang belief yun, sir, kasi you live life with no regrets. And that's what's important in life.
Medyo ano pala ito, Madam Daming show pala ito. Hindi ako prepared. Sorry.
And then first part lang naman, sir.
Okay,
pero sir, from chemistry, paano kayo napunta sa ano, sa nuclear science or nuclear chemistry?
Okay. So, okay, yung pinaka-background ko, yun nga, bachelor's ko ay chemistry sa UP Diliman. But when I graduated, I definitely wanted to do some masters. Pero I didn't want to parang go so hard, too hard sa chemistry. Sabi ko, ano, ayoko nang masyadong, alam mo yun, super focused doon. I wanted to broaden my perspective. I wanted to, and so parang nafe-feel ko na I would rather go to some applications, parang ganyan. And among the applications, I felt strongly sa environment. So environmental science, environmental research, hindi pa nga research at that time eh, basta environment yung gusto ko. So I ended up taking ano, MS environmental science. Pinaka highlight siguro doon, one of the most memorable ay yung isang class with Sir Ando, Dr. Siringan. So it was a class ng reconstructing some past environments sa sediments. Actually elective ko lang siya doon sa MS ko, pero it was one that really ano, impacted sa akin at parang sobrang interested ako sa mga naging topics doon. So parang medyo nag-lean ako doon. And then afterwards nga, eventually I was able to work in PNRI. Not again by some chance, but and then again it's a meeting of opportunity and life decisions. So it is my first and only job, by the way. So mag 15 years na ako sa PNRI ngayon. So and then while working there, eventually natapos ko yung master's ko in BSI, and then I had the opportunity to take PhD in nuclear engineering and management sa University of Tokyo through the office. That opportunity was coursed through the office. And yun, thankfully na napili naman ako doon at nakakuha ako ng PhD sa Japan. So maybe I can say na yung field ko ngayon is an overlap nung tatlo, yung I'm a chemist, particularly an analytical chemist, and then leaning towards environmental science, and then of course yung pinaka isa pang base ko ay nuclear science. So it's chemistry, environment, and nuclear science. Parang ganun yung field ko ngayon.
Actually, ano nga siya, sorry, ang amazing kasi all of them are connected in some way. And the base of that is actually chemistry, di ba, sir?
Mm-hmm. Yes,
so,
tama po.
Yung parang, yung the knowledge you gained from your bachelor's degree, na-apply mo siya, sir, during your MS, and then eventually towards nuclear science. So it's amazing how interconnected or interdisciplinary yung naging ending field ninyo, sir.
Yes. So when I was going through it, sabi ko, paano kaya mag-fit lahat ng experiences ko together? Pero somehow, yun, nandito na ako ngayon. So meron palang way to na mag-overlap yung tatlo. So it was a fun journey at then, and it's still fun journey right now.
Yeah. Ayun. So sir, since your current field is nuclear science, and yun nga, congratulations by the way on the 15 years of UST PNRI.
Yes. 15 years na pala. Lumitaw na naman yung age natin.
Pero sir, wag ka mag-alala, hindi mahalata na ano. Hindi mahalata sa itsura. Ayun, pero sir, segue na ako ng onte. Punta na tayo dun sa dalawang paper, which is a part of the main topic natin for today. So yung unang paper was published in 2016. So this was the historical records of nuclear activities from iodine-129 in corals from the Northern Hemisphere. And the second paper, which was published in 2020, a historical record of the impact of nuclear activities based on iodine-129 in coral cores in Baler, Philippines, an update. So itong dalawang paper na to, sir, since medyo connected naman sila, sir, can you explain or explain your paper in one sentence, yung dalawang paper, since connected naman?
Okay. So the two papers sila, essentially, it's one big study naman. So to say it simply in one sentence, so in these two papers, we reconstructed yung impacts to the Philippines ng mga past and various nuclear activities all around the world, and incidents pala performed around the world by measuring yung tinatawag na iodine-129 in corals. Ayun, simply put, yung ginamit namin yung iodine-129 sa ating corals to reconstruct yung impacts ng mga iba-ibang nuclear activities na nangyari around the world na eventually nakarating sa Pilipinas.
So sir, for the benefit of our listeners, our viewers, bakit iodine-129 and why is it an isotope yung ginamit ninyo to specifically look dun sa ating coral samples?
Okay. Itong work na to is started with my PhD dissertation, and yung expertise or specialization nung sensei ko, particularly nung laboratory nung sensei ko sa University of Tokyo, Japan, was the technique. It's called accelerator mass spectrometry or AMS. So AMS yung ginagamit natin for radiocarbon dating. Probably the most popular application ng AMS is C14 dating. But dahil nga powerful siya, it is also a great technique to measure yung very trace, very small amounts ng isotopes like yung iodine-129. Now, So humans, they started to do a lot of nuclear activities starting noong around 1950. So we call this the start of the nuclear age. Pangit lang introduction ng nuclear science and technology sa world because it was introduced by bombing Hiroshima and Nagasaki with a nuclear bomb. So ganun nakilala nung world yung nuclear science and technology. But it started there. 1950 was the nuclear age. And during this, a lot of activities and incidents, for example, nuclear bomb testing, nuclear weapons making, nuclear fuel reprocessing, nuclear accidents happened na nung mga yon. And almost all involved either directly or indirectly fission ng uranium. This is where you split the nucleus of uranium to generate energy. So the fission of uranium, since in-split natin yung nucleus, it creates a lot of other elements through the process. Yung tinatawag natin na fission products ito. So pag nag-fission ka or nag-split ka ng uranium, makakaproduce ka ng various fission products. And one of this is iodine-129. So maraming characteristics sa iodine-129. One, mahaba yung half-life niya, more than 15 million years. Madali siyang sundan sa environment. Relatively medyo stable yung behavior niya sa environment. Known yung behavior niya. Known din yung sources niya. And so, we could use yung iodine-129 to trace back yung mga nuclear activity. So, dahil nababasa siya ng AMS, and for all the other characteristics ng iodine-129, it was a good choice to use to reconstruct na itong impacts of various nuclear activities in the past. So yun so muna so far.
Okay, so ano pala
siya, sir? Nasagot ko ba yung tanong?
Oh sir, nasagot naman. Yeah. Pero the second question connected to that is why look at coral reefs? And ano yung connect niya in terms of storing such information such as yung acquisition ng or absorption ng iodine-129?
Alright. So, corals, particularly lahat naman ng corals, pero what we're looking at are the massive ones, yung parang boulder, if the people are not familiar with it. Kasi usual chorus ay branching yung na-imagine mga tao, but the one we're looking at are the massive ones like varieties. So they can grow for a very long time. So matatanda yan sila. Some of them are 100 years old, some of them more. So you could imagine that it grows and grows throughout the years. And throughout this growth process, ang nangyayari, a lot of things get trapped in their skeletons, which are mostly calcium carbonate. So one of the things that get trapped there is iodine-129. So if we study yung cross-section ng itong mga corals, massive corals na nga ito, so we could measure or read or analyze for various things, and we could reconstruct whatever happened in the ocean throughout the years that the corals were growing. And so in our case, we were measuring iodine-129. So pag may nag-spike na iodine-129, we know that some kind of nuclear activity had an impact on us. So we are in a tropical country and dami nating coral, so it was just natural it is a good sample, a good medium to study. And ano lang, it was fortunately lang din, kung i-compare mo sa ibang records, for example, sediment cores or coral cores versus sediment cores. And ano ba, usually sediment cores kasi yung ina-analyze ng mga ibang researchers. Mas magandang tumingin itong iodine-129 sa corals because we found out na sa sediments medyo parang hindi ganun kaganda yung detail. I guess because medyo nagmo-move yung iodine-129 sa sediment column. So parang medyo broad yung mga peaks, for example. Pero sa corals, ang ganda ng detail. So ang ganda ng reconstruction na nagagawa natin for the impacts ng ng nuclear activity. So yun. So it's definitely a good choice to study for this kind of study yung ating corals for those reasons.
So sir, basically, meron kayong, paano natin siya napipin dun sa mismong, alimbawa, nabanggit nyo kasi kanina sir yung, tawag dito? Yung nuclear activity.
Yes.
So we can associate that particular spike in iodine-129 to a specific nuclear activity. So bali sir, in tandem siya with carbon dating, if ever, parang ganun ba?
Okay, ang corals, pag at least the modern ones, the easiest way to date, yung malaman yung date ng corals is just by taking an x-ray image ng corals. Pag in x-ray mo yung corals, makikita mo may light and not so dark and light bands yan siya. So makikita mo it's an alternating light, dark, light, dark, light, dark. So that one band corresponds to 1 year. Kasi yung density or yung growth ng corals is one of the factors that affects that is yung init ng seawater. And so annually, parang nagpa-fluctuate lang yan, at least dito sa atin. Mainit, medyo malamig, mainit, medyo malamig. So makikita mo sa x-ray na the density varies annually. And then one of the easiest ways is to count. Just to count yung bands na to. And you know what part, what year of this coral is. And then kung may spike doon na iodine-129, you know that the iodine-129 spike here. So that's the easiest way. But of course, there are more sophisticated ways. For example, we could use strontium and calcium amounts dun sa coral, which also varies using with sea surface temperature. So we could relate that. And then we have a more scientific or mature sure way to date the corals. You could use, in our case, ang currently ang ginagamit namin, merong tinatawag na 3D X-ray computed tomography. Parang high-tech lang siya na X-ray. Ito ay nasa Admatel sa ITDI sa Bikutan. So it's a very high-resolution 3D X-ray. We take a 3D image of the corals, and then you could even scan the coral for its gray value, tinatawag na gray value, of each pixel of that high-resolution image. So it's just a value telling you how dark or how light each pixel is. But again, the how dark or how light each pixel corresponds to the density of the coral, and the density corresponds to the SST. And so pwede namin i-match yung gray value with fluctuations ng SST. So currently, so para ma-sure kami dun sa age, we do that. So we get the gray values, we match that with SST. So hindi na lang siya just manual counting, but we have those more sophisticated para lang mas maging sure kami sa age model. And so pag alam mo na yung date ng bawat parte ng coral, And then you know which years nagsispike yung iodine-129. So through that process, we could, through that research, we could actually say exactly when. Well, I mean, no, before, because there are records, for example, kailan nag-detonate na nuclear bomb sa may Pacific Ocean. May mga Pacific sites, eh. One of the biggest testing sites ay nasa Pacific Ocean. There are records of those, and then we counter-check that with records of what we saw in the coral. So now we could say exactly when it will reach, kung may sumabog na nuclear bomb sa Pacific, wag naman in the future. We know how long it will reach the Philippines and how much are we expecting from these kinds of activities because of the information na yung nabinigay ng coral sa atin. So it's more of understanding the past to be more prepared to of what will happen or what can happen in the future.
Yun. So ano pala siya? In preparation or preventive measures in a way para mas maging handa tayo sa bad effects ng nuclear energy.
Yes. So one of the applications lang. may connect din siya sa Anthropocene, but that's a totally different topic pa ulit. So ayan.
So sir, nabanggit nyo kanina, part to ng inyong PhD dissertation. Yes. So did you receive any funding para dito or part siya ng isa pang project when you were doing your dissertation?
It started as my PhD dissertation and thankfully, I didn't have to shell out anything. It was mostly funded through the lab of my sensei sa University of Tokyo. So yun, so nagsimula siya doon. It was a part of dissertation funded by the lab. But then when I returned here, one question, it started with a dissertation, but parang tuloy-tuloy yung question. May nasagot kang question, may new questions that pop up. So I still continued this work. It's still continuing until now. So there was a project that was funded by DOST Picard when it was my first ever project, and yung current ngayon na funded pa rin ay NRCP naman. So still continuing itong topic na to. Yun, masaya pa rin. Parang andami pa rin question na gusto namin sagutin, but we have answered some of the questions way back, but then yun nga, maraming bagong questions that pop up. So tuloy-tuloy pa rin siya.
Yeah, and I think sir, as researchers, parang yan talaga yung ano natin eh. Yan yung constant na laging may tanong na lilitaw at lilitaw right after we answered a particular question.
Actually, excited kami sa ganun. So nasagot namin to, then another question. So it's just natural to pursue further. Parang ganun. And then, alam mo yun, di mo alam kung saan ka mag-end up or saan ka ililid ng mga questions na to, but the curiosity and the fun of it lang din na sagutin sila. So it's part of the process, yeah.
With that, sir, sa dami, I mean, ilang years na to, sir, so since PhD. So ano yung mga challenges na na-experience nyo while doing this series of researches? Ayan.
Okay. So as I've mentioned, nung pagbalik ko ng Philippines after I finished PhD, this is actually my very first research project when I got back from Japan. So bagong project leader, and definitely itong experience ito, it was nothing short of baptism of fire. Baptism of fire talaga siya. So I had to learn the system, I had to learn the rules, regulation of doing research, procurement, for example, permits na needed to get the corals, budget, everything. So yun, lahat yun talagang kailangang aralin. Also, probably one of the reasons why I chose not to do a postdoc after my PhD. So when I was thinking, I knew I wanted to return sa Philippines, and I decided na babalik na lang ako kagad kasi I decided that learning that kind of system as early as I can was more beneficial for me than doing a postdoc. At least ganun yung yung mental process ko, yung thinking process ko. Ang swerte ko lang, I was still hired by PNRI. I did my PhD while being hired by PNRI. And so after my PhD, wala akong problem sa paghanap ng job kasi I had a job to go back to. Yun lang yung swerte ko. So one of the reasons is that, yun nga, hindi ako nag-postdoc because I wanted to dive straight away na matuto mag-project, mag-research project dito sa Philippines. And all those things I had to learn through this first research project na I think this was the Picard funded project. It was a very steep learning curve. I made a lot of mistakes for sure, some hard lessons. Looking back, I realized that this project, kahit ngayon with my experience, looking back, I realized hindi pala talaga madaling i-implement yung project na yun. Medyo mahirap i-implement yung project namin na yun. But definitely because of that first project, that baptism of fire, I learned a lot. I'm a bit better now at implementing research projects. Thanks from the lessons that I learned from those. And yun, I'm very thankful of the experiences. Ayun so far.
Ayun, sir. Kumbaga nga nun, di ba? Para yung sinasabi nila, para matuto kang lumangoy, kailangan kang lumusong dun sa malalim na part ng dagat. And I think, sir, nandun ka agad. Tinapon ka agad dun sa malalim.
Tinapon. Totoo. Muntik na malunod. Pero nabuhay naman.
Oo. Kinaya naman, sir. At least, di ba? We learn from those experiences. And siyempre, sir, looking back, siguro tinatawanan mo na lang din yung mga experiences mga nangyari before. And the good thing is, you came out better, you have learned, you're wiser, and you're implementing research projects better.
Yes, totoo po yan.
So, connected to sir dun sa challenges, tatanungin ko sir yung mga specific na experiences na memorable sa inyo. So we have three categories, the good, the bad, and the ugly. So dun muna tayo sa goods.
Ang hirap naman. Pwede bang ano na lang, pero parang mix naman sila lahat. So parang I outlined some memorable experiences na lang siguro. Number one, of course, is fieldworks. They're both amazing experiences, but also very challenging. Especially do sa project namin, medyo challenging talaga yung logistic no fieldwork. Dealing with corals, we had to dive, scuba dive, and then medyo may far-flung areas yung mga project sites namin. So we had to bring all the diving equipment from Manila to there, and then usually it's haba din ng mga sometimes it's 15-hour ride, mga ganyan. So definitely logistics wise very challenging, but the experience itself is amazing. Parang yun, hindi naman once in a lifetime kasi multiple times namin ginawa, pero the experience was amazing, and it tested and also raised yung limits I thought I could do. I mentioned some hard lessons, for example. So we had some mistakes wherein hindi ko na pala kayang ma-reimburse yung some big expenses. So as a project leader, madalas, you know, we're already shelling out our own money, and we made some mistakes na, oh no, sabi nila, hindi mo pwedeng ma-reimburse to. So but eventually I decided I was ready to shoulder the burden. I decided definitely I won't let my staff or some share the burden ng expenses na yon. Pag project leader, eventually din lahat ng mistakes na mangyayari kasi sa project would of course will be on your shoulders, parang ganyan. So that experience taught me and made me prove to myself then that I would go through lengths for the people under my care. It was a hard decision yung nangyari dito, but I'm happy na throughout the process, medyo malupit din yung internal conflict ko nun, but I'm happy that I think I made the right decision looking back now. But in the end, I was safe din naman. I didn't have to shoulder that burden parang by some kind of divine providence din. Pero yun, later ko na lang yung nalaman, ay, nakaligtas pala ako, pero I was already ready to to shoulder that. But yun, it taught me a lot then. Of course, yung academic journey, yun nga, nasabi ko nga, it's amazing and fulfilling. And it's still continuing until now. We transitioned from studying yung nuclear weapons testing, yung Fukushima accident, yun yung unang focus. And now, yung current project, it's now already in the West Philippine Sea. So we found out medyo elevated yung iodine-129 in the West Philippine Sea, and we don't know where it is coming from. So yun yung current focus on projects. So, and we're making policy recommendations about it. And so I believe that it has been and still is exciting work for me and for us. So, and I'm happy that we can still continue doing it until after all these years. I started my PhD 2013, na-conceptualized to mga early 2014. So almost a decade na ito na I've been working on this topic. So it's still very happy doing it pa rin.
Yun naman yung importante, sir. You're having fun at the same time you're enjoying what you are doing. And nagulat lang ako, sir, parang ngayon ko lang ulit, ngayon ko narinig yung elevated na iodine-129 level sa West Philippine Sea. I mean, medyo nag-raise siya ng eyebrow.
Hot topic pa naman ng West Philippine Sea.
Hot topic siya.
Totoo nga.
Ibalik ko lang, sir. So yung focus nyo before was on the eastern side, eastern seaboard ng Philippines, tama, sir? So your coral samples were collected, if I'm not mistaken, Aurora, Baler Aurora, no, sir?
One of the sites sa Baler. Yep. But also so, in Palawi, we also had a coral in Calaguas, and we were able to analyze one from Surigao din as well. So buong kanan, eastern side talaga ng Philippines. Yeah.
So with that, sir, may correlation ba yung length kung kailan dumating yung signals from the Fukushima accident towards the signals na nakita nyo dun sa samples?
So far what we saw is that it takes around 3 to 3.5 years for anything that released sa Fukushima to reach us. So that was crucial information kasi Fukushima accident yung inaral natin. Pero lately, yung parang a few months ago, ang naging hot topic uli yung magre-release ng water from the Fukushima site, di ba? Na yung mga parang remediated water, so sobrang dami, after they process it, they had to release it back. Although it's safe according to the IAEA, of course, ang dami pa rin na-alarm. But yeah, because of that information na nalaman natin sa corals, we know that if they release it, kung may mga karating man sa atin na signals or some other radionuclides, we will only see it about 3 to 3.5 years after. So currently, so nagpapanik na. So we know that it won't reach us that quickly. So at least, so mga ganun yung example na because of what we learned in the past, we will know what to expect kung may mangyari pa uli currently or in the future pa. So parang ganun.
Yun nga, sir. Kaya ko din natanong kasi nga yung pag-release nga ng tubig sa Fukushima, na galing Fukushima. And parang since nga hindi pa to tapos, sir, kasi series of sunod-sunod siya na research topics na nanganak.
Yes.
I-limit na lang natin siya, sir, dun sa ano, sa recent paper ninyo. At what point, sir, na na-realize nyo na yung results nyo for the paper on yung sa Baler were sufficient enough to merit a publication or to submit for publication?
So the way we design our papers, feeling ko para kasi siyang pagkain. Pagkain. So dapat pag nag-publish ka ng paper, parang yung nakakabusog lang. Pag naghain ka ng pagkain na bitin, mabibisit lang yung kakain. Pag naghain ka naman ng paper na sobrang, alam mo yun, sobrang punong-puno, busog na yung kakain, di naman niya maubos. So usually we try to find yung just the right amount of kwento. Basta nabuo na yung kwento and just the right amount of, alam mo yun, isang buong kwento siya. Kahit malaking study siya, basta meron ng isang buong kwento na perfectly digestible. So I think that's when we decide na ito, okay, pwede na itong part na to, pwede na itong i-publish at i-go na to. So basta ang mga rules din, in one of the lessons, we want to be as sure as possible before publishing. So mahirap yung nangyari din naman to in the past. So na-publish mo na siya tapos ay may mali pala. So mas mahirap magbawi. So it happened actually, kaya naging dalawang papers to. So kasi nung una, nung nag-PhD ako, hindi pa ganun kagaling yung age dating powers namin. So ito, we just interpreted it at best as we can yung sa current age dates. Mm-hmm. And then we publish it. But then later on, nung nagkaroon na ng more sophisticated ways of doing the age dating, sabi niya, medyo may mali pala dun sa interpretation, or dapat pala i-update natin yung interpretation natin. So kaya mas mahirap yung ganun na kailangan mo pang mag-publish ng another one just to update your interpretation. So as much as you can, as feasibly possible, be as sure as you can dun sa data mo, dun sa interpretation mo, para alam mo yun, mas mahirap magbawi later on. So at least you can confidently say that with the information as feasibly as I can gather right now in the next few months, for example, ito na talaga yung best interpretation. And yun, we can confidently say na pwede natin tong i-go. So, ayun. Mas maganda na yung sure ka kaysa yung nagmamadali ka mag-publish tapos mali-mali pala. Alam mo yung cringe yun eh. Nung nakapublish na to, so mali yung sinabi. Mag-cringe ka talaga. Parang gusto mo. So, wala lang. So, yun na siguro yung sa experience namin na what I've learned through the years na. So, yun. I want to be as sure and as confident as possible before publishing talaga.
Pero sir, syempre, di ba, we're limited by the technology of a certain time. Pero, yun nga sir, pero ang ano din eh, ang iksi din ng pagitan with the advancement, ang exponential na yung growth ng, or advancement in technology. Totoo. So, totoo. There will come a time talaga sir na may experience din ang iba yung na-experience ninyo when it comes to revisiting the data.
Yes, oo, totoo. So, ano talaga siya? Paano ba? It's not an easy situation, but yes, as long as we do our best lang siguro talaga with what we have right now and what we can feasibly do right now. So, mas mahirap naman yung i-hold mo din ngayon, naghihintay ka ng better technology or better things. Baka naman never na lumabas yung paper mo. So, it's really talagang papakiramdaman mo yung best balance with regards to those situations, I think.
So, nabanggit niyo na kanina, sir, yung extension to the West Philippine Sea in terms of looking at iodine 129. So aside from that, what are your current plans moving forward with this series of research?
Mm-mm. So currently, yun nga, yung current efforts namin at tuloy-tuloy ito, ito yung focus namin ngayon ay dun sa more of the West Philippine Sea. Through collaboration pa rin po with Marine Science Institute, we were able to get a lot of seawater samples from the West Philippine Sea, but all over the Philippines as well. And yun nga, one of the findings, hindi pa published, pero pwede ba na bang sabihin? Pwede naman siguro sabihin na present naman na sa mga some conferences na around elevated talaga siya, mga 50 to 70%, sometimes twice pa yung elevation ng amount of iodine 129 sa West Philippine Sea. And then we have a new coral there as well. So we have the data. We're currently writing the papers as well. And then through some other publications then from other people, we now have a good idea where that iodine 129 from the West Philippine Sea is coming from. So we're finalizing the papers. But yung isa pang aspect to it is that we are writing policy recommendations. So, hindi na lang siya academic papers, but NRCP kasi yung call na ito is policy research. So, we also reviewed yung mga existing policies natin dito sa Philippines. And apparently, kung, for example, hindi namin ginawa yung research project na yun, no one would discover na mataas pala yung iodine 129 sa West Philippine Sea because we don't have the systems in place to really monitor for this stuff. So yun yung ni-review, paano nga ba dapat baguhin. We consulted many different agencies as well. So may mga recommendations na lilitaw from this project na dapat ganito, may systems in place na dapat binabantayan natin to. Kasi kung hindi, meron na palang nangyayari around us. For example, hindi pa natin alam kung wala tayong regular systems to really monitor for this stuff. So currently nandun yung focus namin, and tinatapos namin yung current, ito yung phase na to currently.
Grabe. Parang, wala, na-stuck up ako dun sir sa alam nyo yung possible source. Parang gusto ko mag-fish out.
Later na lang. Pag may paper na. Paper muna.
Okay, sir. Sige, sige. Paper muna. Pero, I mean, may idea ko, pero syempre. Pero yun, sir, I'm very much looking forward dun sa paper niyo na to. Specifically, para malaman kung sino. And of course, sir, yung other aspects pa, are you looking at other isotopes or radioactive isotopes ba aside from iodine-129?
So we will try siguro in the future. Currently, may na-fund kami na very big program. Malapit na mag-start. Although, medyo iba yung focus niya. It's on nuclear fuel cycle naman. But one of the equipment that we will get from that program is a triple, quadruple ICP-MS. And that equipment can analyze for uranium isotopes, plutonium isotopes. May laser ablation component. May laser ablation attachment din na makukuha through this big program. And so one of the possibilities, kung meron interested mag-thesis, for example, or kung may grant na makukuha later on, is the same coral samples we will analyze using the laser ablation, possibly analyze for other radionuclides like what I mentioned, uranium, plutonium, other possible radionuclides using this new equipment. And then ibangga siya dun sa iodine-129 data. Definitely, that data would be very interesting to tease out. Some ideas for the future. Pero yung equipment definitely darating yan. And then the samples are just archived in our lab. So kung may mga interested, so you're free to explore the topic.
Yeah. Ayan. So yung mga nakikinig, may interest on looking at nuclear energy. Na-excite ako sa triple quad.
Opo, malapit na sa malamang early next year siguro yung commissioning if all things go well.
Ayun. Looking forward to that, sir. Tapos mag-ano na ang project. Ipo-propose na ang project.
Yeah, let's go.
So, sir, before we let you go, we had fun talking to you. What would be your advice to aspiring researchers who are listening or watching us today?
Okay. Sige, advice for aspiring researchers. A career in research, if it is for you, yung siguro unang thing na kailangan nyong ma-decide for yourself is a career for research. Do you feel it? Is it for you? Pero of course, mahirap decide kung walang information, di ba? So I suggest look out for information. Find out as much as you can kung paano ba magkaroon ng career in research as a scientist. And if you feel like it is for you, it can be very fulfilling. So I can say that hindi pa naman ako ganun katanda. Medyo young researcher pa rin naman ako, young scientist. But currently, I find it very fulfilling. Financially, it is fulfilling. Hindi naman super yaman like todo yaman, but financially, it is more than enough. Intellectually, and in my case, spiritually, it's this career is very fulfilling. There are a lot of opportunities. Kung hindi pa kayo nakapag-master's or PhD, for example, there are a lot of scholarships, there are grants, and so finances is seldom an issue when you want to pursue a career in research. So if you think research is for you, there are many ways. I suggest seek help, find the opportunities and go for it talaga. So yung talagang kagustuhan mo lang yung drive mo, yung more number one factor, yung kagustuhan mo to go for these opportunities would be the more driving factor for it. And finally, I believe try to pursue yung things and topics that you feel most passionate about. In my case, I eventually did. Currently, I'm pursuing what I really want. I have been nabanggit ko na I've been in PNRI since 2009, so it's going 15 years October. 15 years na sa October, but I find that I'm still really excited to go to work almost every day. So currently, kahit 15 years na, parang alam mo yun, parang masaya pa rin ako pumapasok. I'm excited what the day has in store. So definitely, I think that can only happen if you pursue the things you're passionate about. You cannot sustain. Mahirap i-sustain yung mga bagay pag medyo alam mo yun, hindi ka ganun ka excited to do what you're doing. So help each other and keep the fire burning. To keep the fire burning, siguro yung pinaka ma-advise ko. So I think yun po.
Ayun, thank you very much, sir. Sobrang grabe. Ano yung parang sir, yun nga sabi niyo, yung researcher, yung scientist pa kayo, pero ang dami na rin namin wisdom na makukuha from your experience. And ayun nga, passion at passion pa rin talaga yung mag-aano sa'yo, magdadala sa'yo kung saan mo gustong pumunta. So, with that, sir, do you have anything to promote to our listeners and viewers?
Sige, promote. Siguro, follow us lang yung aming social media pages. Yun na lang siguro sa Facebook na lang ipopromote ko, but there are other platforms. One is yung page ng PNRI, that is, ang pangalan niya ay PNRIDOST, facebook.com/PNRIDOST. So yun yung page ng buong Philippine Nuclear Research Institute. But if you want to follow us more closely, may page din po yung aming section. I'm heading yung Nuclear Materials Research section na tinatawag. So we also have a page for that. That is facebook.com/NMRSPNRI. So at least yung dalawang page po yun, sana ma-follow nyo if you're interested with what we're doing. So yun lang po.
Ayan. So guys, paki-follow ang si PNRI and DOST, PNRI NMRS na Facebook pages to get updates and information about the current state of nuclear energy and nuclear chemistry here in the Philippines. So with that, sir, thank you very much again for sa pagpapa-unlock sa podcast namin.
Maraming salamat din po. Thank you for inviting me, and hopefully ayon yung mga may natutunan po kayo or may napulot kayo sa mga na-share ko this afternoon. So it was a great time being here. So maraming salamat po.